Hey, how's it going, brothers and sisters? And welcome to today's prophetic sermons in the Lord Jesus Christ. For today's prophetic word is coming from Sister Glenda Lomax. And it reads, "My children, you have long prayed for those you love to be saved. I have told you I will save those being interceded for in these times. How I've saved them may not look like you imagine. And it may be later than you hoped, but do not fear. I am well able to arrange their circumstances to get their attention on me. I will be as gentle as they allow me to. Do not rescue them when you see me do this, but intercede before me for them. In this time, you will also witness me dealing with those who have a reprobate mind. I have given them much time and many opportunities to turn back to me, but they repent not. Because they continually choose the world and their sin over me, judgment will now fall in their lives. My children are feeling an increase in the burdens I have laid on their hearts. My children, I am increasing the burdens on each of you to intercede for lost souls for me. Millions walk in darkness in your world, and many have no one to intercede on their behalf. They would perish without ever knowing of me if you do not do this. Pray for me to send laborers into the harvest. Pray for me to soften their hearts and move on their circumstances, for me to draw to them. Pray they will surrender completely to me. I beseech each of you to set aside some small space of time each day to answer this call. So many souls depend on you for this. As you take the time to do this work for me, I will grant you answers to many things you have asked of me. I desire you would be very blessed in this time, that all the world may see there are rewards for serving the King." Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for this prophetic word. Thank you so much, Father, for a word of encouragement in this time where there is much sadness, much depression, much fear and uncertainties that is happening all about us. And so, Father, as we move into your prophetic sermon, we pray that you will continue to do your mighty work in the hearts of your people who will be hearing this message, O God. May I be your vessel. May I be your mouthpiece. May you send forth your word to the masses that you desire that they hear upon this day, and that they can move forward, Father, into seeing that not only will their loved ones be saved, but even many in a distant parts of the world that no one ever intercedes for, that they will see in heaven how their time in prayer was not in vain. And so we thank you, Father, for reminding us that as we continue our pursuit in a move of your kingdom and your kingdom purposes, that in turn, O God, you will begin to bless us, Father, with the desires of our hearts because we have been obedient and faithful in obeying you. Father, we love you. We thank you for this time. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, brothers and sisters. So the scriptures we're going to look at briefly to help give us words of encouragement and insight to how we ought to conduct ourselves for the time to come. We'll begin in Matthew chapter 6 in verse 24. And it says, "No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat, or what you shall drink, nor yet for your body what you shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? Behold, the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much more than they? Which of you by taking thought can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. Yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God, and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And so, brothers and sisters, in the reading of the scripture, we are very familiar with the lessons to be learned from this, from the time that we were young, even to the current age that we're in as of today. Some of the highlights that I want to pull from this, from those of you who've already understand the lessons of the scripture, and for some of us who needs a refresher, is that when it comes to our needs being met, the Lord is not ignorant to what is required. The Lord is aware that we need our nourishment, that we need food, that we need water, that we need shelter, that we need clothing, and that there's many other things. We need to be loved. The Lord is aware of all the things that his children need because he created us. And he put us upon this earth with all the provision that we will ever need in this life, so that we can have a full life and a prosperous life, and that we may enjoy all the many treasures that he has laid up along this road that we're walking with him until the end. But you see, the reason why that sometimes we can find ourselves in lack, it's not always our fault, but there are times when there are decisions that we've made in the past that moved us from that path that the Lord has set up for us to walk. And so therefore, we got derailed from the road of provision. We've got derailed from the road that contains our promise. We've got derailed from the vision that the Lord has had for us from the very foundations of the earth. And so in this derailment that happens from a combination of things, whether it is because we made a choice, or is it because, or rather because a family member who derailed off the path made a choice, and so therefore there's this generational line of derailment that happens to where even the children and the children's children is off this path, that there are a lot of things that we miss, and a lot of things that we've never got to experience that should have been ours to enjoy if there was obedience from the very early ages of our generational line. So many different things, so many different scenarios. But what we are to understand today is that the great work that Jesus did for us on a cross, not only did it set us free from the power of death, and not only do we have the gift of eternal life, which is the biggest thing of all, really, what the Lord did on a cross has made a way for restoration, for all the things that we've been denied, for all the things that we've missed the opportunities to enjoy because of sin. The sacrifice that the Lord has done for us on a cross has led the way for an opportunity of restoration of all those things. For all those things to once again come back into our lives, that we may enjoy those things even in a time that is left, the time that we have remaining before all things change. It is the Lord's good purpose and will to bless his children in such a mighty way in these times that we're living in. It is not his will that we live in depravity, that we are in lack. It is not kingdom purpose. It is not. But you see, when we read the scripture, and the Lord highlights that he knows what we need, and that he highlights that he is aware of what our heart's desires are, he says that in order for you, though, to get back into that road of promise in which a decision you made derailed you, or a decision that those who came before you made derailed you. He's saying in order for you to get back to that straight and narrow of blessing, you need to make my business the priority. Verse 33 says, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Because the blessings of God, the provisions of God, the promises of God, the rewards of God, everything that he has set aside for us in this time for us to enjoy has been aligned from the very beginning with the purpose of his kingdom. And so when we decide this day whom we shall serve, that we shall serve the Lord God Almighty and not the world. Because when the decision comes to serve either God or mammon, the reason why many would serve mammon is because they desire to serve the world. You see, money is what gives us access to so many things that the world offers, which ultimately can lead to our utter ruin. And so the Lord is saying that I can be your access to the very blessed and greatest experiences that life has to offer. But you need to make a choice and choose. Will you choose me to be your access to the greatest things that are reserved for you? Or will you choose money to be the access of the worst things that not only have you already experienced, but the increase that it will continue to add to your life until the very end? And so we're given an opportunity here. And what shall we seek? You see, is it wrong to have money? It is not. But it is wrong when money becomes the priority of our life over God. Putting God first, serving him first, seeking his kingdom first, is what subjects money under the authority of God. And so therefore, when money is subjected under the authority of God, then God in turn can use that which has been in subjection unto him to bless you with the things that you need. And even more. And so today, the Lord has given us the opportunity to put kingdom purposes first. And one of his heart's desire is for all to be saved. And we read this in the scriptures. He desired that none should perish, but come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And so by making this time out that the Lord is asking us to do today, by praying and interceding for the lost, we are then meeting the Lord's heart's desire. Because you see, in the selfish state that we are in, we're so focused on ourselves, on what we want, on our heart's desire, and are always asking the Lord to bless us with our heart's desire because we can be so self-centered at times. But yet, we don't take the time to ask the Lord what is his heart's desire. And so you see, we have an opportunity to bless the Lord's heart by giving to his heart's desire. And what is that? For all men to be saved. And it is only right that we do this little thing for the Lord, which is not really a little thing at all compared to the great harvest and return that could come into his kingdom. But this one small act that we can do for the Lord, it's the least we can do, especially with all that he has already done for us on that cross. And so putting the kingdom of God first, and we know that the Lord does not lie. He says it in his word, seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, his ways, is the key that naturally opens up the doors for rewards and blessings that we've had been praying for years. Because it says that when we seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, the Lord concludes by saying, and all these things, not some, not most, he said, all these things shall be added unto you. And that is his promise to us. From the very beginning, we had a purpose. From the very beginning, we had a promise. From the very beginning, we had rewards and treasures and blessings of many kind. But in order for us to truly walk in that favor, we need to get off that detour that we've made. We need to get off that path of derailment that we allowed to exist and get back to that beaten path of the kingdom. Matthew 24 says, who then is a faithful and wise servant, whom his Lord hath made ruler over his household, to give them meat in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Verily I say unto you that he shall make him ruler over all his goods. But, and if that evil servant shall say in his heart, my Lord delayeth his coming, and shall begin to smite his fellow servants, and to eat and drink with the drunken, the Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of, and shall cut him asunder, and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So here's the highlight here. Here's the highlight. Is that when the Lord begins to grant you all these things onto your life, because you sought first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, we must never forget that the blessings that we have is not solely for us to enjoy, but it's also to be used to further his kingdom purpose. You see, in the world, there are many office of authorities that exist. You know, we have CEOs of businesses. We have government officials that sit in very prominent positions. We have in the military of offices where there are key positions that is set. But you see, the office is different from the person. The purpose of the office is to support the organization that it was created for. That office is not an individual, but is a position of authority. And so there are people who are granted opportunities to sit in these offices, all from the Lord, to carry out a certain function. But when that person has fulfilled their term in that office, that seat is now vacant of that individual, and someone else comes into that office and fulfills the requirement. And so the person who originally sat in that office no longer has the same pull, no longer has the same perks, no longer has the same authority that they once had, because that office was never meant for the person. That office was meant for the organization. And so now when we understand this basic principle, we have to really capture in our thoughts that in the future to come, as we continue to seek first the heart of the Father instead of our own hearts, and that is seeking and saving the lost, sending out laborers into the harvest field, spending time in intercessory prayer for lost loved ones and lost souls in places that no one ever intercedes for. And the Lord begins to start blessing our life. Understand that the blessings that we shall receive is like a person who sits in an office of authority. You see, when you sit in an office of authority, there are things and privileges you get to enjoy. And so you are encouraged to enjoy these privileges. So is it with God's reward? God expects you and encourages you to enjoy these privileges and rewards that he shall give you. But never forget that these privileges, these rewards, these perks you shall have in this season is not meant to serve you. It's meant to serve God. It's meant to bring him glory. And so when we look at Matthew 24, you have the two different servants. You have the faithful and wise servant who was given an office of authority over a household. And so with that office was many rewards and privileges that he had the opportunity to enjoy. But with that, it says in verse 45, to give them meat in due season. So as he sat as ruler, there was a responsibility to give to those, to help to those who are in need and sitting in the office of his Lord. But then you had the evil servant who disregarded the purpose of the office. And so instead of remembering that the office was not made for him, thought that he was made for the office. And so he began to smite his fellow servants, began to act like the world and eating and drinking and getting drunk and being worldly of all kinds and abusing the very rewards that they've been petitioning for and was given graciously by our God. And then the Lord's reward, well, his warning is sure, that it says that the Lord will come in an hour that evil servant is not aware and shall cut him asunder and shall appoint him his portion with the hypocrites, where there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And so as a final warning, brothers and sisters, that as we begin to go forth and being about the Father's business, and then he begins to bless us in turn, we have to be on guard in our hearts that we do not allow the blessings and the rewards of God to drive our hearts away from him, leading to our ultimate destruction. That would be one of the biggest temptations of God's people as the Lord begins to start edifying them and raising them up for the world to see how the Lord take care of those who are his, is that we may become full of ourselves, full of the world, and full of condemnation at the end. And so this concludes our prophetic sermon for today. And before we go into prayer, let's go ahead and read the prophetic word once more. And it says, my children, you have long prayed for those you love to be saved. I have told you I will save those being interceded for in these times. How I save them may not look like you imagine, and it may be later than you hoped, but do not fear. I am well able to arrange their circumstances to get their attention on me. I will be as gentle as they allow me to. Do not rescue them when you see me do this, but intercede before me for them. In this time, you will also witness me dealing with those who have a reprobate mind. I have given them much time and many opportunities to turn back to me, but they repent not. Because they continually choose the world and their sin over me, judgments will now fall in their lives. My children are feeling an increase in the burdens I have laid on their hearts. My children, I am increasing the burdens on each of you to intercede for lost souls for me. Millions walk in darkness in your world, and many have no one to intercede on their behalf. They will perish without ever knowing of me if you do not do this. Pray for me to send laborers into the harvest. Pray for me to soften their hearts, move on their circumstances for me to draw them. Pray they will surrender completely to me. I beseech each of you to set aside some small space of time each day to answer this call. So many souls depend on you for this. As you take the time to do this work for me, I will grant you answers to many things you have asked of me. I desire you would be very blessed in this time, that all the world may see there are rewards for serving the King. Let us pray. Father, we thank you so much for today's sermon. Thank you so much for the power of your word to transform our hearts for the better, for the greater glory of your name and for who you are. And so, Father, we pray that you will raise up laborers into the harvest field and that they shall go out and do the great work that you have purposed for them to do from the very foundations of the world. We pray, Father, that you shall raise up mighty prayer warriors, O God, great and small, wherever they may be, O God, to spend this time in intercession, O God, to intercede for the lost souls, O God, that many will be added to your kingdom. May you help free up our times, Father, in the morning, in the afternoon, in the evening time, to write out the prayer list, O God, of souls that we desire to be saved, O God, and that we'll begin to put up maps, O God, in our prayer rooms, O Lord, and start pointing at places in the world and start making your declaration of salvation in these nations. May you start putting together prayer groups, O God, prayer lines, O Lord, prayer walks, O God, through the nations in the name of Jesus, that wherever your people will go, that they will begin to start declaring your word of salvation in the spirit, O God, and start interceding for these lost souls, O Lord Jesus, that many shall be added to your kingdom as well. Because you said, Father, that you desire that none should perish, but all come to the saving knowledge of you, come to the knowledge of everlasting life. This is your heart's desire. You have always asked us, Father, about our heart's desire, and that you desire to bless our heart's desire, Father. But now, Father, it is time for us to stop being so selfish and so self-centered and consider yours. And this is your heart's desire. So raise up a mighty lion in your people this day, O God. Mighty boldness in your people, O God, to start declaring your word, Father, into the atmosphere, into the heavens, O Lord, to start raising up voices of praise, O God, and petition and prayer, O Lord Jesus, that shall be echoed through all of eternity, and that there shall be a mighty harvest that is brought in to your glory, O Lord, because you have the few and the proud and the faithful that interceded in the small things in this time. Father, we love you and we thank you for this time of coming together as a family, of fellowshipping, and may you strengthen our hands for this season that is upon us. We love you, Lord, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
This world has nothing for me. This life is not my own. I know you go before me, and I am not alone. This mountain rises. trust in you, and we will be shaken. We will trust in you, and we will not be moved. We will trust in you.